Hi friends, how are you all? So I have come up with one more video on maximum PowerPoint tracking or maximum PowerPoint techniques algorithm. Let us see. As we know, the renewable energy sources are nowadays very much renowned because we have very less availability of coal, which is very abundant source of electricity nowadays. But still we are unable to get it in a proper amount as the coal is goes on depleting already. So we need to see the other abundant sources. Yes, we have abundant sources of solar energy and we have abundant sources of wind energy. So that's why we are seeing the renewable energy sources nowadays. So these are the very good impact. The basic disadvantage of renewable energy sources are they are abundant, but still they are not concentrated or they are not frequent. I mean, they are intermittent in nature. So basing on these things, the maximum power point tracking algorithms or maximum power point techniques are very good things. So let us see the brief discussion of all these techniques. So basically these are for PV system. For wind system, maybe the similar things or similar methods have been adopted. Let us see. Introduction. So what is the necessity of these MPPT techniques? So these are very much necessary for PV applications because the PowerPoint, the maximum PowerPoint, actually we are getting, as we know, there are two quantities. One is open circuit voltage, second one is short circuit current. Those are the maximum points. So obviously if we multiply these two, we need to get the maximum PowerPoint. But this doesn't happen in real life because the current never be maximum. Maybe the current never be maximum when the voltage is maximum, and vice versa. So there is one compromising point, and at that point is called maximum power point. That means where the current and voltage are maximum, maybe optimum. That means the current will be current at maximum power point and voltage will be voltage at maximum power point. They are definitely less than the short circuit current and open circuit voltage respectively. So what exactly the maximum power point depends? So the maximum power point of a solar panel varies with the irradiations and the temperature. So these two are the main points where the maximum power point varies. So because of this thing, we need to have maximum power point tracking algorithms. So over the past decades, there are so many methods was invented and developed, and they were also published in so many journals. So these are the outcome of the past decades research. So let us see what are the main factors on which the maximum power point techniques differ. So the main factors are required sensors. So based on the requirement of the sensors, the techniques will differ. And the complexity, maybe the simple techniques are there, the complex techniques are there. Cost, range of effectiveness. So some techniques may be useful for up to certain range and some other techniques may be useful for some other range. Convergence speed, some techniques may be fast to get the maximum point and some techniques may take much time. And correct tracking when irradiations and our temperature changes. So if the temperature changes, the tracking should be proper. Some techniques have the proper tracking in a shorter time and some other techniques may not track properly if the irradiations change in a wider range. Coming to hardware needed for the implementation or the popularity among others. So they may be the hardware needed for the implementation may change from one technique to other technique, and the popularity may be there for different techniques. That means if some techniques are very much popular because of their less cost, maybe because of their less requirement of sensors, maybe because of their less hardware implementation, or it may track different types of irradiations or different types of temperatures. There may be so many reasons. So these are the factors on which we need to differ the techniques. Let us see what are those techniques. Yeah, these are the maximum power point tracking algorithms or maximum power point trick techniques. So let us see: hill climbing technique, better bend observe technique, incremental conductance technique, fuzzy logic control, neural networks, fractional open circuit voltage, fractional short circuit current sweep, particle swarm optimization based algorithm for PV systems. The last and final one is MPPT in hybrid PV, hybrid photovoltaic and wind energy conversion systems. So these are the different systems we are going to discuss in this video. So the first one is hill climbing technique. Let us see what is meant by hill climbing technique. So algorithms are based on the hill climbing principle, which consists of moving the operating point of PV array in the direction in which power increases. So we need to move forward such that the power has to be increased. That means we are calculating power in instant 1, then it has some power, and if we calculate the power at instant 2, if this power at 2 may be P2, if P2 is greater than P1, then we need to go ahead with 0.3. If P3 is greater than P2, then we need to go ahead with P4. If P4 is less than P3, we need to finalize P3, and that will be the maximum power. So in this way, we need to go ahead with hill climbing technique. So these are the most popular MPPT methods due to their ease of implementation. So the implementation is very easy in these type of techniques. So they are very much popular, and the performance is also very good if when irradiation is constant. So this is one of the drawbacks. If the irradiation is constant, its performance is very good. That means it may work for maybe extensively for 4 to 5 hours only, maybe, because the irradiations may change rapidly after that time. Okay, that's what the hill climbing techniques are. So the basic advantage of these methods are, obviously we have discussed now, the simplicity and the low computational power. It takes very less power to compute all these things. Okay, those are the advantages of hill climbing technique, the basic technique. Coming to perturbed observe technique, this is also one type of hill climbing technique. So the perturbed observe algorithm is also called hill climbing, but both names refer to the same algorithm depending on how it is implemented. Let us see how it will be implemented. Hill climbing technique involves a perturbation on the duty cycle of the power converter, and PNO perturbed observe technique is a perturbation in the operating voltage of the DC link between PV array and the power converter. Of course, both leads to the same thing. In the case of hill climbing, perturbing the duty cycle of the power converter implies the modifying the voltage of the DC link between the PV array and the power converter. So both names refer to the same technique. So in this model, in this method, the sign of the last perturbation and the sign of the last increment in the power are used to decide the next perturbation. So the basic difference between perturbed observe method and hill climbing method are, as I already explained, for the hill climbing method, if P4 is less than P3, he will directly take P3 as the maximum power point, and he will stick to that. But coming to perturbed observe method, he will reduce the limit of delta D, maybe that part. So perturbation, he will reduce that part, and he will check one more point in between 3 and 4. For example, at point 3.8, maybe 0.3.8, the power may be high. Then he will take he will go here and there. He will go to left side and right side, left side and right side, and he will keep on reducing that limit so that he will get the exact or approximate thing of maximum power point. That means, for example, if P3.8 is maximum power compared to P3, he has to take P3.8 as the maximum power for perturbed observe method. And again, he will see the maximum power, he will compare the maximum power with P3.7 and P3.9 also. If these two are less compared to this, then he will finalize that P3.8 is the maximum power for this thing. So in that way, perturbed method will go. Coming to hill climbing method, he will simply say that yes, P4 is less compared to P3. He finalized the P3 as the maximum power. So that is the difference between these two. So the last point will give us the basic difference between these two. Let us read once again. In this method, the sign of the last perturbation and the sign of the last increment in the power are used to decide the next perturbation. So definitely here the perturbation is not at all the constant. So we are keep on see, we fix one perturbation, for example, change in duty cycle as 0.5%. Okay, that is the perturbation we have set. For example, we keep on going ahead just like hill climbing method only up to when the last power is less than the previous power. If that condition happens, definitely he will reduce the duty cycle to 0.25, like that, and he will keep on reducing it, and finally he will come to a conclusion that the maximum power occurs at one point. So in that way he is going. So that's the difference between perturbed observe method and the hill climbing method. Let's go ahead with some other methods. Yeah, incremental conductance method. So this is also one of the good methods. So here the incremental conductance algorithm is based on the fact that the slope of the curve power versus voltage of the PV module is zero at MPP. So this is the basic criteria in incremental conductance method. So here the power versus voltage, so power versus voltage will give us the conductance. So in this, power versus voltage or power versus current, you will see, and if the change, the slope of this is zero, then maximum power point occurs. So otherwise, see, positive on the left hand side of it and the negative on the right hand side of it, what will happen? Yeah, this is the exact point of maximum power point. If the change in voltage to change in power equal to zero, or change in current to change in power equal to zero, that's what the incremental conductance method is there. That means you need to keep on seeing that part, maybe change in voltage to change in power or change in current to change in power, and that should be zero. If it is less than zero, you need to move right side. If it is less, I mean, you need to move right side. If it is, see, for example, see here we need to understand carefully. This should be power versus voltage. If power versus voltage, that means delta V by delta P is positive. Okay, if power versus voltage is positive, that means the red color one, this part. This part, if power versus voltage, this part, you can just see this part only, not more than that. If the power, I mean, change in voltage versus power is greater than zero, that means, now let me change the color of it, this red color. Yeah. If first I need to see the power and voltage, that means delta V by delta P is greater than zero. That means if it is positive, how I need to react on left side. So if it is positive, I need to go ahead with left side. If it is negative, I need to go ahead with right side. That means the positive side is left side and it is right side. So we need to move towards zero. So that's why we need to move accordingly. Okay. And the next step is, yeah, if it is less than zero, we need to move right side. If it is greater than 0, we need to move left side. As we are starting from left side, we are going to reach 0. If it is more than 0, we need to come left side. Okay, that's what the basic idea of incremental conduction method. So by comparing the increment of the power versus the increment of the voltage or current between two consecutive samples, the change in the maximum power voltage can be determined. So in this way, we need to find the voltage at MPP, and that will be the change in that voltage will be determined. Next, the fuzzy logic. So the use of fuzzy logic control has become popular in these days because these last decade it has been very much popular because it has so many advantages. So it can deal with imprecise inputs. So the inputs may be linguistic inputs or normal inputs, numerical inputs. So it doesn't need an accurate mathematical model. If you don't know the model also, if you know the input and if you know the required output, you can go ahead with fuzzy logic. It can handle non-linearity. Suppose there is any non-linearity in between voltage and current, still it can handle the same. It's fast convergence, so it takes a very less time to converge to the outputs, and it has minimal oscillations around the MPP. So the oscillations are also very much minimal. So these are the basic advantages of fuzzy logic. So that's why in many research activities, the fuzzy logic is one of the controllers. The fuzzy logic, so what is meant by fuzzy logic? So the fuzzy logic basically consists of three stages. One is fuzzification, inference system, and defuzzification. Let us see. Fuzzification means comprises the process of transforming numerical CRISP inputs into linguistic variables based on the degree of membership to certain sets. So to learn much about fuzzy logic, you can see my videos. I have a bunch of videos under the heading fuzzy logic playlist. So you can go ahead with them. They are very easy only. So this is meant by fuzzification. So it converts numerical CRISP values into linguistic variables. In the next step, the number of membership functions used depends on the accuracy of the controller, but it is usually varies between 5 to 7. So in some cases, the membership functions are chosen less symmetric or even optimized for the application for better accuracy. So the choice of membership functions depends upon the application purely, and in how better you are reaching towards your outputs from your inputs is the matter. So based on that, you can change your membership functions accordingly. Okay, that's the beauty in fuzzy logic. So the next, coming to the rule base, it's also very important, and rule base lookup table for fuzzy rule algorithm. So all these things are the different names for it, and it is associated with the fuzzy outputs to inputs based on the power converter used and the knowledge of the user. So definitely we should have proper knowledge how to reach the outputs from inputs. So the last stage of fuzzy logic controller is the defuzzification. So in this stage, the output is converted from linguistic variables into numerical CRISP values using membership functions. So the basic thing is everything happens by using the rule base, and everything happens in fuzzifying environment. So fuzzifying environment means you need to first fuzzify it, at the end you need to do the defuzzification. So basically I can categorize into three parts. One is fuzzification, rule base, and defuzzification. That's all. So coming to the next part, so the next technique is the neural networks technique here. So this is also very another important technique which is adaptable to microcontroller. So it's very easily adaptable to microcontroller, and this may be used maybe along with fuzzy logic also. So these two techniques are called soft computing techniques. So the simplest example of neural network has three layers: input layer, hidden layer and output layer. So these things are shown in the figure. So these are the, this is the input layer. So let's see it. This is input layer. And second one is hidden layer. So this part is the input layer. This is hidden layer and this is output layer. So these are called the input neurons. So this layer is the input layer and this is hidden layer and this is output layer. So in this way, the neural network, the inputs are given in this way, and here we need to apply some activation function. Even I have developed the bunch of videos for the neural network playlist also. You can see in the description box so that you can have better idea on this. So here we need to use activation function. So you can change based on this activation function and the output over here, you need to change the weights here. That means you can change the weights here. So this is what your main job in neural networks. So more complicated neural networks are built, adding more hidden layers and more type of different types of layers, and the number of layers and the number of nodes, and that means number of neurons in each layer, as well as the function used in each layer, vary and depend on the user knowledge. So that function is called activation function. So that depends upon the user's flexibility to reach towards the outputs. So the input variables can be parameters of the PV array, such as VOC and ISC. So these two can be taken as the input variables, and even the atmospheric data can also be taken, maybe from irradiations and temperatures, and or a combination of these. So any combination of any of these four can be taken. Any of them, definitely we need to take VOC or ISC at least, or irradiations or temperature at least, if they, those two are interdependent. If they are not interdependent, we need to go ahead, we need to take all the four, or we need to use one neural network for VOC ISC and one neural network for irradiations and temperature, and then we need to combine both of them. In that way, you can see so many varieties of it, and you need to always see the computational time and the complexity of the network. You need to reduce the complexity, you need to reduce the computation time, so that you can reach your outputs quickly and in a simpler manner. So the next one is, to execute this training process, data of the patterns between inputs and outputs of the neurons are recorded over a lengthy period of time, so that the MPP can be tracked accurately. So we need to see in a lengthy manner. So that means in a full structured prop, we need to train the neural network. For that, it needs too much of data. It needs too much of data in a variety of data. That means every day, if we take the data and if we input to the, if we train the neural network only from maybe in India from 10 o'clock to 2 o'clock, that's not sufficient. And yes, from 10 o'clock to 2 o'clock, the sun is almost the same. So we need to take much more data, maybe from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. If you take it, then that will be very good for us. So the main disadvantage of this MPPT technique is the fact that the data needed for the training process has to be specifically acquired for every PV array and location. So for each and every PV array, we need to do the same thing, and in each and every location we need to do the same thing, as the characteristics of PV array vary depending on the model and the atmospheric conditions depending on the location, as the inputs are not constant. It changes, it varies from one place to the other place. And neural network is very keen, it cannot take approximate values. If it takes approximate values, means definitely it will give you very bad results. Okay, that's the disadvantage of this network. Yeah, coming to fractional open circuit voltage. So here it uses the approximately linear relationship between the MPP and VOC, which varies with the irradiations and temperatures. So VMPP is equal to K1 times VOC, where K1 is the constant depending on the characteristics of PV array, and it has to be determined beforehand by determining the VMPP and VOC for different levels of irradiations and different temperatures. Once the constant of proportionality K1 is known, the MPP voltage VMPP can be determined periodically by measuring VOC. So basic disadvantages are, to measure VOC, the power converter has to be shut down momentarily, so in each measurement a loss of power occurs. So another problem of this method is that it is incapable of tracking the MPP under irradiation slopes because the determination of VMPP is not continuous. One more disadvantage is that the MPP reached is not the real one, because the relationship is only an approximation. Okay. There are two types of techniques. One is fractional open circuit voltage and second one is fractional short circuit current. So to get the maximum power point, we will approximate the maximum voltage such that it will be in a fraction of maximum voltage. So the maximum voltage is VOC. So we can take VMPP is equal to K1 VOC. Now let us see what is that fraction. And definitely that fraction has to be dependent on irradiations and different temperatures. So how can we calculate that fraction? Definitely we need to calculate maybe the previous experience of the solar panel. We can calculate that fraction. Done. That thing is okay. That's an approximation we have taken like that. Now how to find VOC then? For this is the main advantage of this. So to measure VOC, the power converter has to be shut down momentarily, so in each measurement a loss of power occurs. So in each measurement of VOC, we need to shut down our power converter. That's the disadvantage of this method. And similarly, this is not a very good method because this is an approximation method. So we need to take approximation for this. So definitely this is not the perfect method. So similarly, in the next step, same thing happens for the short circuit current also. We will take here one constant K2 that also depends upon, just like this only, our K1 depends on irradiations and temperatures. So these same problems may be there for this thing also. So measuring the short circuit current while the system is operating is a big problem. Okay. And it usually requires adding an additional switch to the power converter to periodically short the PV array and measure ISC. So these are the disadvantages. So to calculate VOC and ISC while the system is going on, it's not at all possible. So that's the disadvantage in these two techniques. So coming to current sweep. So in this method, the VA characteristics of the curve is obtained using a sweep waveform for the PV array current. So at some point they will use a sweep waveform such that they can track the VA characteristics. So the sweep is repeated at fixed time interval so that VA curve is updated periodically, and the MPP voltage can be determined from it at these same intervals. So at these same intervals we need to calculate the maximum voltage. On the other hand, the sweep takes certain time duration which the operating point is not the maximum power point. For example, this is the one of the disadvantages of this, and let us see. Yeah, this is the power point. This is power curve, power versus voltage curve. For example, if this is obviously this is the maximum power point. Yeah, this is power. So this is MPP. So at this maximum power point, but if this in sweep network, for example, if I have taken this sweep, if my sweep network is working at this point, maybe at this point, maybe at this point, maybe at this point, maybe at this point, if you keenly see, it will track this point voltage at this point and voltage at this point, voltage at this point, voltage at this point and voltage at this point. But the real voltage lies here, and this is the real point at maximum power point. So in this way, it may miss, as within the two intervals, the maximum power point may be missed off. So this is the one of the disadvantages of this current sweep method. So the next point is, it is strictly speaking, it's not possible. Okay, let's wipe off this. Yeah, strictly speaking, it's not possible to track the MPP under irradiation slopes, because the MPP varies continuously. If the irradiation slope, suppose the irradiations are, maybe slopes means the irradiations are very huge, that means high range of irradiations are there, there is a much change in irradiations, then the MPP obviously varies. So definitely we can't get based on the current sweep. So this is the disadvantage of this method. Only if the sweep is instantaneous, the global MPP could be found, but that is impossible. Yes, how can we find instantaneous sweeping? That means in each and every point, for example, I feel that at point 1 and point 2, point 3, if I am using sweep, I feel that at each and every point I am using my sweep waveform. But you may come one day and you may say that at 1.1 and at point 1.5 and 2.5, 3, then only it will be at all points. Some other may come and he may say at point 1, 1.25, 1.5, then only it may be. So we can't say that as the points are infinite, we can't take sweep, we can't apply sweep waveform at each and every point. Okay, that's the difficulty in this current sweep method. Furthermore, the implementation of complexity is high. Obviously, it is high. Even though you are periodically taking the sweep waveform, it is very much high. And the convergence speed is slow. Obviously, it will be slow. And both voltage and current measurements are required. That is very much disadvantage in this method. So the next method is particle swarm optimization. So this algorithm is used to reduce the steady state oscillation to practically zero once the maximum power point is located. So it has ability to track the maximum power point for the extreme environment conditions like large fluctuations of insulation and partial shading conditions. So this is a very good technique for different conditions. That means if the insulation is largely fluctuating or there is a partial shading condition, then obviously this method is only the option for us. The maximum power point tracker based on particle swarm optimization or photovoltaic module arrays is capable of tracking global maximum power point of multi-peak characteristics curves, where the fixed values were adopted for weighing within the algorithm. The tracking performance lacked robustness, causing low success rates when tracking the global MPPs. So if you track the global MPPs, that means there are two types of MPPs, a local MPP and global MPP. That means you need to set for two points and try to find out the MPP, set for other two points and try to find out the MPP. In that way, you need to find the best out of all these MPPs. So to find that MPP, there may be some less success rate in the particle swarm optimization. This is the disadvantage. Though the maximum power points were tracked successfully, the dynamic response speed is very response speed is low. Okay, it takes much time. The PSO based MPPT controller algorithm for various environment conditions like fully shaded conditions, partially shaded conditions, to find new global MPP with reinitialization of particles can be observed. So this is the very much important point. So in different scenarios or different environmental conditions, we can get the MPP. So coming to particle swarm optimization technique has some advantages there. It is simpler in structure and easy to implement, fast computational capability, It can locate MPP for any type of PV curve regardless of environmental variations, and also so to track the PV system as the set space of the PSO reduced and time required for the convergence can be greatly reduced. Okay, these are the advantages of PSO. So the PSO based MPPT can be used to predict the IV and PV characteristics of curves during partial shading conditions and also to evolve and ratify the photovoltaic systems design encompassing the power converters and MPP controllers. So in these times where the partial shading is there, where the insulation is fluctuating, definitely we need to opt the particle cell optimization. Yeah, this is the hybrid PV and wind system. So this is the final slide of this presentation, and let us see the basic things of it. So this is my wind generator. So as we know, the output of wind generator is AC, so I need to convert this AC into DC by using a rectifier here. So this is my DC. And here I have used DC to DC converter, the boost converter. So this may be my MPPT converter. So I can use MPPT to change this, to change the duty cycle of this MOSFET or IGBT. So here I need to use my MPPT, maximum power point technique here. And similarly, so at the end I will get the very good DC, maybe boost DC or fixed DC or very good DC or MPPT controlled DC. Okay, whatever may be, I have very good DC here. And from solar panel also, this is my same, this is my converter, boost converter, and this is even here also I need to use MPPT controller for this MOSFET or IGBT. So again I will get the DC here, obviously very good DC. So these very good DCs are through battery chargers, they are charging the battery, and through this it will go to the this point, and the here the capacitor is there, DC link. So this is called DC link here, and after this there is a DC to AC bidirectional converter, and through which we can connect a load here, three phase load. So here the figure shows it's three phase load, it is an AC load. So in this way we can maintain the hybrid PV and wind system. So as you know, this is not grid connected, this is simply standalone system. So this is a simply standalone system. In this way we can connect or we can integrate the wind energy system and solar PV system after application of MPPT controllers, and those two are given to battery charger to charge the battery, and that will be given to the DC link capacitor such that there is a proper voltage, that means proper voltage supplied to DC to AC inverter. And hence after that you need to control the inverter based on your load requirements, then you will get the proper AC. So this is what the exact picture of hybrid PV wind system. So in this way MPPT convert techniques are used to get the proper DC, fixed DC from different variable. As we know, PV system is also, the input is variable, and from wind system also the input is variable, but still we make it as a constant DC and we keep on charging the battery, and finally we will maintain the perfect voltage at DC link capacitor so that it will be transferred to the AC load through inverter. Okay, this is what exactly happens in hybrid PV wind system. So these are the basic advantages of MPPT techniques. So thank you so much for watching this video, and if you like this video, please like it If you want to share this video, please share with your friends and family. If you haven't subscribed to my YouTube channel, please be subscribed and try to press the bell button so that you will get the notifications whenever I upload any video. Thank you so much.